Isaiah chapter 1, we left off with a sick nation, a sick church. Chapter 1, the first book of the Bible, Genesis. And we saw Adam and Eve sick when they took that fruit of the knowledge of good, from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Woman would be in sorrow of childbirth. Man would be sweating and death. Pain came from Genesis 3. Disobeying God. What the nation is doing now. What the church is doing. Disobeying God has a result of putrefying sores, wounds, bruises, death. Even the Lord's Supper, it says if in Corinthians, Paul writes, if you don't take honor to what it is, some sleep, death. Some are sickly. What you got to realize is when we disobey God, He tells us things for right and for good. He wants the best from us. And we left off last night in Isaiah chapter 1. We left off with Sodom and Gomorrah. Cities that were been destroyed because of sin. And I believe it's Ezekiel or Jeremiah said, it wasn't just sodomy. It was idleness, America. Much bread, America. That the sins had acquired to God in heaven. The cup became full. Judah's cup is not full, but it's getting full. When did it get full? When God called Babylon in. And the long suffering, the mercy of God is He sent Babylon 3 times. 2 times as a warning. Then the 3rd time, gone. Then long-suffering God, they were able to go back in Ezra and Nehemiah and rebuild. But it says in verse 9, except the Lord of hosts had left unto us a very small raiment, we should have been as Sodom, we should have been like unto Gomorrah, destroyed. Yeah, but God promised Abraham. How sure is the word of God written in ink? Go back there and read Genesis chapter 12. And that is the only reason why there's a nation called Israel, Jews, today. Because God adheres to His word, and you better have the right word. That's how important it is not to change God's word. 2015, that promise passed to Abraham and Genesis chapter 12 is still going. That rainbow from Genesis is still in the sky and still reminds God of what happened between God and Noah and the animal. And it's not a sign of sodomy. It was a sign of a covenant. You changed the word of God. Don't you see that? You say that the rainbow is a symbol of sexual gratification of wickedness. If I can put those 3 words together. No, it was a sign between God and the animals. Hear the word of the Lord, ye rulers of Sodom. Wow. We should have been in Sodom and Gomorrah. Okay, you rulers of Sodom. Doesn't that say that? I believe it's in Revelation. It calls the city of Jerusalem as Sodom and Gomorrah. Give ear unto the law of our God, ye people of Gomorrah. Wow, the wickedness. The shamefulness. That, oh, we want those men to have our pleasure. Oh, here, take my daughter. To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me? Now, God is going to say something. You're going to say, well, wait a minute. Here's a contradiction. I've read the law. I've read what Moses told them in Leviticus and Deuteronomy and Numbers. And that sure does not play along with Isaiah chapter 1. Well, let's read Isaiah 1, and then let's see what the contradiction is not. To what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifices unto me? The law said, bring them. Free will, burnt offerings, trespass offering, all of them. Saith the Lord, I am full of your burnt offerings of rams, and the fat of fed beasts, you know, beasts that you fed. They're fat, overfed. I delight not in the blood of bullocks or of lambs or of the he-goat. Go back and read Leviticus, Deuteronomy, and Numbers. God says, that's what I want. God says, when you give that animal, that animal is not to have no extra parts, not lacking parts, not bruised, not scurvy. And this is the way you're to do it, exactly, precisely. Nahab and Abihu walked in and lit the incense altar, not by God's way. And they became the matchbook brothers. Uzzah went up and touched the ark. He had feelings for the Lord. It's going to fall down. And God struck him dead. One of the kings walked in there to offer incense. God strikes him with leprosy. God says, you're to cut this animal in pieces, drain all the blood, put the pieces on the altar, upon, you know, what the animal's supposed to be, where the parts go, and burn them persistently, and go to this place and do it persistently. And God says, here, I'm sick of it. There's no heart into it. It's become a ritual. Now, do you know where I'm going to go with the church on this one? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be thy name. This to the bead, and this bead, and this little bead, and that little bead. And oh, Lord, thank you for our meal and our fellowship we're about to have. And at this moment, we're going to sing for 15 minutes, and we're going to pass the plate around, and then we're going to have into this, and then we're going to have the service for exactly 45 minutes. And we're going to be definitely out of here by noon, because all the vehicles in the parking lot turn into pumpkins, and we have to have it all this right and the same way every single time we have for service. You know what I mean? There are churches out there, there's probably a guy with a stopwatch. Okay, time to pray right now. Okay, stop praying. There are churches out there that the pastor, or wherever you want to call him, believe it or not, he has in his office a calendar. All right, today is Matthew 14, 36, whatever that is. That's Sunday's message. And that's the same message every year on that date. Every year, Easter, all the women get new dresses, and you get nice flurry lilies and palm branches and all, you know. And God says in Revelation 3, I'm sick of it. Do something different. Do it from the heart. I'm knocking on the door, and no one's coming out to me. It's not from the heart. It's become a ritual. And that's where the church is today. That's where Israel was. You know where they're going to end up? They're going to end up in Babylon. When ye come to appear before me, who has required this at your hand to tread my courts? See, what's that talking about? Well, son, why are you here? Mom and Dad dragged me. I wanted to stay home and play video games. Mom and Dad dragged me out. Why are you here, sir? Well, my girlfriend I just met, she comes to church, and you know, to be a pleaser and all that, I come to church. Ma'am, why did you come to church today? I get the greatest gossip. I get the greatest news. And then we work on a quilt, or we do all kinds of women day things. Gets me out of the house. You're gonna have a fellowship dinner after church. I don't have to cook. All the free food I want. I don't bring nothing, but I'll have free food. And God says, why are you treading my courts? What is the motive? What is the reason? Why are you here? You don't see Genesis? Cain?
Yes, Lord.
Where's your brother? You my keeper? Why are you here, Cain? Why'd you bring your offering? Did you bring it because of a willing heart? Evidently you didn't, because God didn't please with it. If Cain would have brought an offering that he really wanted to please God, God would have received it. Are you telling me God is so cold to say that he didn't even touch his offering and he didn't say, Cain, I know you love me. I know you want to do right, but can you do a little better than that? Can you stop having a little, I got the joy down in my heart. I got the joy. What about God's joy? Why are a lot of the new contemporary music, I, me, and nothing, God? Well, I go to church, yeah, because I can talk to people because I need work. I can work on their health. Listen, I've met people in church. People come to church to sell insurance, to get business deals, to sell cars. I've seen it. God said, why are you in my court? You imagine being called up at either judgment, the great white throne judgment, or the judgment seat of Christ, and find out that you weren't there for the Lord. You were there for something else. What God is saying. Do you go to church to hear from the word of the Lord? Are you sitting in church and your pastor has a boring message? Are you sitting there, well, Lord, it must not be for me today. Lord, there's somebody you're speaking to in this building. Let their ears be open. Let there be no flies flying around. Let there be no bugs creeping around. Let their heart be attending to your words. And when the pastor says something for me, Lord, let my ears be open. Are you going to the courts of the Lord to hear from the Lord? Now maybe, you know, if I go to church today, the way things are today, I may be the only one in the church for the pastor. Don't be funny. Well, I don't want to go to church today. You don't go, and then you find out everybody had that idea. And then the pastor gets up in the pulpit, looks out there, and all he hears is crickets. You know, someone who keeps a pew seat warm, the pastor has someone to talk to. Someone to deal with. Why are you going? Why are you putting your money in a collection plate, verse 11?
Oh, 10:40 right off. God's sick of it. Well, if I make my presence known, if I give this or do that, you know, I'll get recognition. God's sick of it.
Bring no more vain oblation. Vain, empty. Remember we studied the book of Ecclesiastes, vain, vanity? And you know what? They are bringing exactly what God told them to bring and bringing exactly. Didn't it say, it said back here in verse 11, the fat of fed beasts, bullocks, lambs, goats, they're not bringing dogs, they're not bringing alligators, they're bringing what they're supposed to, and they're bringing animals, they're fattening the animals up for God. Do you see the Gold family today? Their animal wasn't as fat as our animal. I saw the collection plate. There was a lot of $1 bills in it. I put a 5 in there. Ooh. Oh, my family sat in the pew. You see the family? They were missing somebody. They were in church. 8 in the morning, whatever time your Sunday school, they're there. They're there for 10 o'clock, whatever your service time is. They're there Sunday night, 6, 5 o'clock, whatever time it is. They're there the midweek service. But they could be there for another motive and not for God. You know the most disgusting thing I heard? There are people that go to, now there are churches, like our church, midweek service is prayer. However, everyone prays, whatever, you have prayer requests, whatever, however it's done. You know there are people that go to prayer requests, write down the prayer request, so they can talk about what's wrong with that family? Well, that family, all the kids are sick. When are they doing to get sick? You know, that family, the kids got the measles. I wonder where they got the measles from. Well, look at that. Her husband fell back into alcohol. Oh, look at that. He's an alcoholic. She's going to have another baby. She's got enough of them already. She's going to be too little active. What's wrong? After this, we got an email from church. We're going to give you the name of a woman and what the thing said. What the email said. We're gonna pray for her. I'm not gonna go around gossip. Bring no more vain oblations and emptiness. It's you bring it, but your heart's not in. God wants a broken contrite. He doesn't want you to give because you have to. Corinthians. Grudgingly. No one sees me put money in the plate. Oh, they're gonna be a little room. Incense is an abomination to me. What was Zacharias doing when the book of Luke opened up? What were the people doing? They're waiting. It's a time of prayer. They were there because they wanted to pray. They were there seeking God. And that book opens up with the promise of the forerunner of the Messiah. Because they were out there praying right. Here, they're burning incense and we're gonna do it. You read Malachi? I don't know if we're ever gonna get to Malachi before death or the rapture. Lord, the table's contemptible. Got to do this again. 4 o'clock, I change the bread. Do it 4:01, it's out of change. You know? Got to record these people's names. And you got to do this. And got to go to the hospital. God says, I'm sick of that attitude. You know, you can feed all the homeless, and if you got an attitude about it, don't chalk it up as a reward in heaven. You can visit everybody that's in the hospital, and you're doing it because you have to do it, don't chalk it up as a reward. The new moon, which began the month, the new moon began the Jewish month. That was the first of the month. And the Sabbath. The calling of the assemblies. You know, when they blew the trumpets. When the feast times. The 3 times a year that the males were supposed to come to Jerusalem. They're doing what they're supposed to be doing. Get that. But they're not doing it with a pleasing heart. They're not doing it for God. Oh, I gotta wrap up. I gotta head to Jerusalem again. You know how far that is. Last time our donkey flew a shoe. Now we got 3-legged donkey. Come on, boys. We got to go count every 10 sheep again. Oh. I'm not looking forward to that trip to Jerusalem. It's got to do it. And you go up to the temple. There's the priest. You got your lamb. Did you read about Eli's boys? Give me that fat. It ain't ready yet. It's mine. What are you going to do about it? And those boys died in battle and the ark was taken. The father fell over a seat and broke his neck. Died. A woman gives birth. He names the child Ichabod. It says there in Samuel's time that the candle went out. An error. Error. That candle was not supposed to be ever go out. It was supposed to be trimmed. It was supposed to be filled. I cannot away with. It is iniquity. Even the solemn meeting. Ooh, church meeting. We're going to meet for church service and we're going to do anything but for God. I got a message that's going to make all the men happy this Sunday. And I got a message for all the mothers on Mother's Day. And I got the nice little Christmas message. And we got the Christmas pageant. And we got the Christmas kids with the Christmas angels and the wings and all that. To please the unsaved family, which is going to hear that little gospel message I'll have afterwards. And they're not there for the gospel message. They're there for their children. But we do it every year. And we don't preach the truth throughout the year about the tree, the Christmas tree. We don't preach the truth that it ain't Jesus' birthday. Oh, if we do, we get up there. Oh, see, today's not really Jesus' birthday. But then why are you having it? And then you expect the people to believe what you said when you just admitted to a lie. There are churches out there, believe it or not, they meet and it's not for God. They do it under the guise of God. Remember Jacob? He comes to his son. How did you get to meet so quickly? God guided my way. No, your mother did. You just did a Roman Catholic. You made Rebecca marry. She answered your prayer. God didn't get you to meet, you liar. In the name of God. Eliezer, when he goes for Abraham, a duty for Isaac, he goes to the well and he bows his knee and he earnestly seeks the Lord in prayer. God, I don't know what I'm doing. I don't know what woman to be there. Lord, I am resting upon you. And Lord, let me just ask, the woman that you choose will come up and say, can I give you a drink? Eliezer is not praising himself. He's praising nobody but God in the honor of God. And God answered that. You know why Lot and his wife and his two daughters got out of Sodom? It wasn't Lot, and it said Lot lingered. It said the angels had to pick him up and grab him. Abraham was down on his knees praying. You better thank God that God stopped Abraham at 5. Because had he gone any lower, everybody would have been destroyed. Or 10, excuse me, 10. They couldn't find 10 righteous people in Sodom and Gomorrah. And we just read in Isaiah 1 that likened to Sodom and Gomorrah. You know, in Daniel, we read about 4 boys. Are there any other names? Well, I mean, Daniel, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That's 4. Who were the others? Eight people got into the ark. Your new moons, that's the beginning of the month. Your appointed feast, that's the 3 times a year in all the feasts. the harvest seeds. My soul, that's God. My, that's God. Soul hated. Can you imagine if I was an Isaiah, Jeremiah, and walked in church and stood up? God hates the service! What you doing? Jeremiah taught about that bell bush! That's not proper. That's not elegant. That's what the prophets of God did. They were told to go into the temple. Jesus went into the temple and broke the tables down! And we can't even go up to the pastor and say, Pastor, what you're doing is wrong. Because he's got a Bible verse to say it's right. See, in Jeremiah, that's not a Christmas tree, that's a totem pole. Well, you can't skip out church to pass out gospel tracts. Say this prayer, you're saved. This is the third time. Amen. Chalk it up. There are church services where God looks down and says, I hate it. You make me sick. There is no God. He's outside the door. And Satan is in the front row amening the preacher. They are a trouble unto me. I am weary to bear them.
Oh, man.
You imagine God up heaven. Please don't say it. Please don't say it. Please don't. Hi, my name is George. I'm a Christian. Oh, man, he said it. Man, there have been some Christians working on that guy, praying for that guy, and that idiot went and told me he was a Christian. We have a movie night at church. You want to come? It's about racing cars and stuff like that. Oh, no, 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 no. You know, we got a Christian movie now. You want to come to the Christian movie? Where George Jones, you know that great actor George Jones, will say he's Moses. Hey, you want to come? You want to come to our Blossoms movie? Yeah, you do? All right. It'll be $12.50. You got to pay for your own popcorn. Pizza, the fellowship afterwards. Yeah. We'll even pick you up with the church van. What do you guys say? I am weary. You know, if somebody's really seeking, I mean truly seeking, they're down and out, they are in desire straight, they're about to be saved. You know how many wrong churches they can go in on a Sunday morning? Wrong churches. And not get the answer. Even God's got to go through his yellow pages and say, well, that guy really needs help. Oh, man, there's no church in that place. Hello, Christian family. Vessels, yeah? How you doing? I want you to go there. I want you to preach on the street because there's no one else in that area. Will you do that for me? Why do you preach on the street, Mr. Hayward? I'll tell you why. Because they're not going to come to church. And if they do walk into church, 99.9% they're going to walk into a wrong church. And they don't even know any better. They'll walk into one church and wine and bread is the way to salvation. They'll walk into another church and selling magazines will be another way. They'll walk into another church, pedal a bicycle will be another way. Walk into another church, be baptized, sprinkled, immersed, or shot with a water gun or a fire hydrant, and you'll be saved. Or go to another church, are you preordained by the foundation of God to be the elect? Going to another church. Oh, what tongues can you speak in order to be saved? I got to ask you something, Christian. How far do you got to go to a Bible-believing, Christ-honoring church? How many churches do you pass? If your church goes knocking on doors, how many churches do you pass to that neighbor that don't go knocking on doors? And there's always that person you say, don't tell them you're a Christian, you're ruining the work that I'm doing for the Lord. Look at this one, verse 15. And when ye spread forth your hands, prayer. You ready for this one? When ye spread forth, God's people, you could be a child of God, saved, and this verse can probably apply to you. And when ye spread forth your hands, I will hide my, that's God, I, God, will hide my God eyes from you, the one that is of God. Oh, Lord, what you doing, angel number 557? God, someone's talking. What you doing? Oh, Lord, God. Cherubim, sing a little louder, please. Oh, love it. Is that how you want God? Is that really how you want God in your life? I brought the offerings. I bring the money. I go to church. I got a King James Bible. I don't want to. I have to. I'm making. I got status. I got clients. Bob Jones Sr. says that if a preacher does not make him feel mean, he's no preacher. Have you ever sat in a church service and got mad at the preacher because he preached the message that was about you? And you got under conviction and you the best way you thought you and God working it out or did get it work out, you plead the blood? Or did you walk out of church with your head tied like a balloon, with a big yellow balloon, with a happy face on it?
Hey, I'm so happy.
And then when the time of prayer comes, why is my prayer being answered? That could be one of the many reasons why your prayer ain't getting answered. There are people in Daytona Beach, Florida, that go to church to be fed and get a shower. I talked to a few people in Norwich, Connecticut. There was only one place for the homeless to go and get a meal. And it wasn't a church service. It was just, I forget what they call it, soup kitchen. There was no service. You just go there and eat. And the government gave the church some money and stuff like that. But down here, there, you know, you got to have the church service to get the food. They're all over the place. So chalk it up when you're at the justice, whatever one, Great White Throne, justice, what'd you go to church for? Here they had chicken. What about Christ? Is that a dessert? What are you talking about? Oh, yeah. I said this prayer. I never knew you. Depart from me. What? Didn't I put $5 in the box? The parking man never knew you. That's the same God that says, when you are known to him, when you spread forth your hands, I will hide my eyes from you. Yay. Now, you didn't think it was prayer? Yay. When you make many prayers, I will not hear. Your hands are full of blood. Murder. Habakkuk 2:9. The nation of Judah are in the process of killing people. The nation. America is in the process of killing people. We're killing babies. Our television and video games are teaching young people how to go kill people. We put a bunch of murderers in one building and wonder why someone gets murdered or harassed or assaulted. We send veterans of the armed services out to fight our battles and bring them home to die on the streets, homeless, penniless. We as a nation, Isaiah is saying, listen, when you pray, I won't hear you. We as a nation, God's not hearing our prayer. We're telling God we don't want to pray to you. And when it said back here in verse number 11, to what purpose is the multitude of your sacrifice unto me? Saith the Lord. Verse 10, hear the word of the Lord. America does not want to hear the word of the Lord. How dare you put the Ten Commandments in a courtroom? That's shame. Making kids in a school pray and bring a Bible. Put you in jail and take your children away from you, you vile person, you. And we sit with churches in this country who are in this condition. We're praying for a revival. Guess what? God ain't hearing you. We're praying for people to get saved, and we're not going to do nothing about it. We're just going to pray for people to get saved. God ain't hearing you. We're praying for worldwide peace and all the children be fed, and you know, all the children in Africa will be cleaned up, and la 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 la. He's got the whole world in his hand. God ain't hearing you. Matter of fact, one step closer, God may not even know you. But it would be a shame for you to be known of Christ as a child of God, and God say, I'm not going to hear your prayer. And you don't have to physically kill somebody. You can think about killing somebody. You can think about killing your boss or somebody who's done you wrong, and you'll be charged with murder. Go ask Ahaz. He didn't have nothing to do with Jezebel in his writing as the wife of Ahaz. He was charged for Naboth's murder. See, you don't have to do the physical act like adultery. Who's ever looking upon a woman? There are Christians out there, because of their thoughts, because of their television watching, because of their video games, they are charged with blood of murder. Oh, I'm playing this video game. Oh, I'm going to kill all these people. I think you better be very careful. Because if Jesus said, whosoever looketh upon a woman and lust after in his heart has already committed adultery with her. Can you imagine you're sitting there playing a video game and in your heart, oh, I got to kill that guy. Oh, I got to kill that guy. Oh, I got to hurry up and kill that guy. If that's the case, how many teenage and young adult Christians that go to church are charged with murder because of a video game? And for those people out there doing the audio, my fingers are like I'm playing a game. Are you saying that if I play a video game, I shoot people that I'm a murderer? Your thoughts count. Are you in the Bible? Are you reading the Bible? You can do that and still read and study your Bible. You know, Paul says to the Corinthian church, God doesn't want anything grudgingly. He doesn't want it because you have to. You know, if you don't want to go to church, don't go. You ain't pleasing nobody. You ain't pleasing God if you don't want to be there. Now, I understand some mornings you wake up, okay, I understand that. That happens to everyone. There's just days you don't want to go. But your general attitude about church, you go because you have to go. Now, a child is to obey his parents. And you go because your parents are making you. I believe you're putting money in the plate just for an IRS deduction. I believe personally that won't be credited to you. You already got your reward when you get that slip of paper at the end of the year. I believe that. And you may not. And if you give your time for any kind of evangelistic service or clean the church, whatever part of your church, and you're doing just so people see that you're doing something, so they can talk about, you know, he's the broom person of the church. God says that's vain. I don't want it. I'm sick of it. Now you do it as a blessing to God, a vessel of God, and to help others and to show others and encourage others. Okay, that's different. Question is your heart and motive as we close in verse 15. Why are you doing it? How are you doing it? For what purpose are you doing it? For who are you doing it? What? What are you doing? How? How are you doing it? Is it the Bible prescription? Who are you doing it for? Are you doing it for God or are you doing it for someone else? If you're doing it to please God, and you will have off days. You'll have days, oh, I don't want to go to church, but you go. Your motive is to be a blessing to your preacher to be there. He doesn't want an empty church. To encourage others. And to hear from God. And to pray to God for others around you. Listen, church ain't just about you. There's a prayer line. There's talking to God. And God is listening to you. Pray for the others around. Listen, we're in the midst of a sick season right now. And you hear people coughing. I say, Lord God, that family, they're just coughing. All the kids, Lord, will you just help them? Lord, I remember the days I was in church. Man, I didn't feel good and my throat hurt and all that. Lord, I was probably with the Lord, will you give them some relief? What's wrong with that? God likes that. Lord, that family over there, you know, just, Lord, just lift them up to you. May come a little more than once a week. Lord, just help them and bless them. And Lord, may somebody in this church who is lost today, may they turn to Jesus Christ as their Savior, Lord God. If nothing else, say, one person will come and the angels rejoice over the Lord Jesus Christ, saving a lost sinner. Lord, this ain't much money. This is what I got. Lord, I'm going to put it in a box, and what do you want to do with it, Lord? It's not much. You know that widow that threw the two mites in there, she didn't tell. Now, I put in my check that there's money I want to go to missionaries, okay? But everything else, I don't go, you know, make this electric light bill, make this for the, you know, I don't do that. Let the Lord. It ain't much, Lord, but maybe someone else will give and things can be done. That's what the Lord wants. Here we are again. Still talking about money. That family over there, here comes the plate. I hate that guy over there. I hope he don't come over and shake my hand. See, look at me, I'm a Christian. You know? It's your attitude. It's your motive. It's your heart. And one of the worst things that can happen, you'll need to pray to God, and God, I'm not going to listen. In verse 14, again, we'll close. Your new moon, your appointed feast. I thought they were God's new moons and God's appointed feast. You see what happened? What was God's is now the people's. It's no longer for God, it's for the people. Laodicean means rights of the people. For the people, by the people, blah, 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 blah. You are in the Laodicean church age in verse 14 when you have replaced God for the people.